Recording. So welcome guys to successfully growing annonas in South Florida. First, I want to tell you a little bit about IFAS Extension. We have an office in all 67 counties, and we also have research centers. Those are the triangles you see in the state. And we have one right next to me down in Homestead. I'm in Homestead because that's where all the tropical fruit and vegetables are. So we have a research center there where we have a tropical fruit specialist. We have a tropical fruit entomologist. We have a pathologist. We have a tropical fruit plant breeder. So I'm able to work with them, and it's very good and lucky for me that I have them so close by. So this is Tropical Fruit Tuesday, and today we're talking about annonas, and December we'll talk about seed propagation, and in January we'll talk about the avocado and also laurel wilt. So if you haven't seen those, then we're going to do those and it'll be worth your while. I see we've already had a question and we're getting some answers in the chat, so that's great. Dr. Green always helps, and Jorge Zaldivar always helps, so that's really helpful to me. So you guys can check out the chat as we go. And another place besides the chat that you can get information is something called Ask IFAS. That's our new platform, has very good documents and publications, all from University of Florida, all peer reviewed. So if you search Ask IFAS UF or Ask IFAS EDIS, it used to be called EDIS, you'll find this page. What can we help you with? You put in there, if you put in there annonas, you'll get about 5 good publications on annonas. So I think you should do that either today or tomorrow or over the weekend. Take a look at everything we have there. Another good place to get information is other universities. So you can type in your search and then type in EDU. That way you know it's good information. YouTube can get you some very bad information, but get you some good information too. The good thing is, you get to see what they're talking about. So that's very important. I put TFT there because all of the past Tropical Fruit Tuesdays are on YouTube. This one's being recorded, so it will go on YouTube probably by tomorrow. And another good place to get information is Master Gardeners. I know we have some Master Gardeners listening today. I appreciate you guys, and I'm glad you're helping out by volunteering. Number one place to get information is your own garden or your own grove. If you see it with your own eyes, it's very important because you know it's true. You got to be out there scouting. You got to be out there looking, walking your grove, walking your garden. That's where you get tons of information. Let's see. Jose, your question will be answered later. So we'll get to that. If Dr. Green and Jorge want to chime in, that's great, but we'll get to that one. So photo credits, take a look at those. Pop quiz, this photo, who does it belong to? Okay, if you got my name, then you're right. Okay, botany of the annonas, they're in the annonaceae, which has 46 genera and 500 to 600 species. So there's a lot of these guys. The important fruit crops are the Atemoya, which we can't grow here, Atemoya, which we can, sugar apple, which we can, Guanábana, which we can. It's a little cool here for that, but we can do it. And then also you have the llama and the pawpaw. Pawpaw is getting more popular, and they come from South Central America and Mexico. So here's a picture of some of them. At the top, you have an Atemoya, which I'll show you some other ones. Some of them look different. And the Atemoya is a cross between, this one is between the Atemoya and Annona squamosa, which we see down at the bottom is the sugar apple, very sweet sugar apple. And then on the left, we see the Atemoya. So these two at the bottom, they crossed them and they got the Atemoya. Okay, so we also have the llama, which you see top left. We have, and you open it up there, you see that one in particular one is pink inside. Then we have Guanábana, also called Soursop. And you see that there. So this one is Annona Montana, the mountain soursop, top left. Then we have Annona Reticulata. This one we can grow here. I had some and I lost them in a hurricane, unfortunately. Bullock's heart, sometimes called custard apple. And then Rolinia Deliciosa, which I've seen that one growing here, I believe. And I'm talking about South Florida in Dade County. Then we have the pawpaw, top left, which is more of a northern fruit. It's gaining popularity as a fruit you would actually eat. Then you have the pond apple, which if you go to the Everglades, I just went the other day, about 2 weeks ago. And if you go to Royal Palm on the Anahinga Trail, there's lots of pond apples growing there. They grow in the water, and this is an actual fruit. And I have been told they're not very good. I'm very excited to try to taste one though, because even though they're not very good, I still want to taste it for myself so I can say, yeah, they're not good. Someone asked, can we grow sugar apple in Vero Beach? I believe you could. Okay, here's some more pictures. Bullock's heart, sometimes called custard apple, there on the left, and then a nice sugar apple on the right, well formed. Here's an Atemoya on the left. These all came off my trees, then except for the soursop, that somebody brought that in and it was really big, you can see. So some of the, just to take a quick look at the sizes, you see sugar apple is smaller than Atemoya, even smaller than that. Guanábana is the big one. Custard apple kind of in between, close to the Atemoya size. So where do they come from? Sugar apple comes from lowland tropical and warm subtropical areas. So it needs it kind of warm, but it's in the lowlands. Atemoya, also lowlands, warm and cool subtropical. So we can grow those. Guanábana, it's in hot lowland areas. And it's getting a little warmer here the last 20 years. It's ticking up. So we have a better chance of growing Guanábana without it getting chill damage. Custard apple, also hot. This custard apple they're talking about is also, I think, the Cherimoya is what Dr. Crane is saying there. So botany, sugar apple is a small, open, spreading, upright tree, 10 to 20 feet tall. Atemoya, also small, but gets a little bigger to 30 feet. I'll vouch for that because my sugar apple in our grove here is, my sugar apples are easier to control than the Atemoya that's much growing quicker. The Guanábana can get up to 35 feet. Now, all of these, you can prune them to keep them 12 to 15 feet pretty easily. They take very well to pruning. We'll talk about pruning towards the end, but they really take well to pruning. So semi-deciduous. So what that means is they do drop some leaves and they start to do that right around now, this time of year. So they get really ugly. So some people will ask questions like, what's wrong with my sugar apple? What's wrong with my Guanábana soursop? And that's just that this time of year, they kind of get ugly, they lose their leaves, and then they come back in the spring. So sugar apple and Atemoya have hermaphroditic flowers. That's a tough one for me. And exhibit protogenous, I can't even say that, dichotomy. So what I do know what that means, though. That means the female flower parts are receptive prior to the male parts. So this is important because that's why you get so few sugar apples and so few Atemoyas, because the flower itself has male and female parts, but they're not ready at the same time. The female is ready earlier and then the male is ready later on the same flower. So the best way to get the fruit is to hand pollinate, which we'll talk about in a bit. So the flowers open female first, then male. So they have female and male phases. So when the sugar apple and Atemoya flowers first open in the early morning, that's when the female parts are receptive. However, by early to late afternoon, the stigmatic surfaces have dried and are no longer viable. So they're ready in the morning, but the males don't come till later. So we have a little disconnect there. So flowers in the female stage have a slight opening. I'll show you pictures of that, and a glistening appearance. I'll show you pictures of that. And in the late afternoon or early evening, that's when the male flowers come around and you'll see the anthers releasing pollen. And if you're hand pollinating, you want to get that pollen. And then in the morning, you would find the female and do the and pollinate it. And the male stage, the flower petals are wide open. So here is a flower on the left, starts very small. Then at the bottom here, it gets a little, it gets bigger, and then it opens like that. This one that I have my cursor on, that one would be female. And then on the far right would be male on this left picture, the bottom far right. So you see in the picture on the bottom right, you see one that's getting ready to be a female opening up, and then there's a male that's already there. So they are there at different times on different flowers. So if you get a pollinator, you can get some of them pollinated, but the pollination rate is very low. Getting some good info in the chat, and I'm not having to answer questions, so that's great. So here are the pictures. Here is sugar apple as a female. So you see it's kind of open, but not open all the way. If you peel off one of these parts of the flower and look inside, you see the female parts there. And I think I have one. So here it is in the male stage, it's much bigger. Then you have some fruit set. I have better pictures. So here we go. You see the glistening in the top left of the female stage. That means it's ready for the pollen. And then the bottom right, you see the pollen getting released. So if you were to hand pollinate, you would take that pollen on the bottom right, keep it, and you have to use it pretty quick. Sometimes you can mix it with talcum powder. And then with a brush, the next day when you had the female parts open, you would brush them with a brush and the pollen. So Guanábana is very similar. They have bigger flowers though. And the female phase is 3 days, then the male phase 12 hours. So it's the same kind of idea, but it takes much longer. And different pollinators, these are scarab beetles. So the biology, the natural pollinators of sugar apple and Atemoya are nitidulid beetles, sometimes called sap beetles. There's the species there. They're attracted to the flowers by the odor emitted by the female flowers. The number of beetles visiting a flower increases 1 to 6 times percent the fruit set increase. So here's one of the beetles. You can, very old picture there on the top left. You can kind of see it in there, there. So beetles remain inside the flowers up to 22 hours. Fruit set due to natural pollination, so this is important, ranges from 0 to 10%. So that's low. For sugar apple, 0 to 29 for Atemoya. So if you're not getting a lot of fruit, this is why. High relative humidity favor longevity of the female phase and increased pollination. So we do have that. So there is a bait system that you can set up, but you need the lure, you need the wheat dough. There's some more information on this that I can send you if you want. The jury is out on this though, that it actually works, because they did some testing and it didn't do too much, but I wanted to just show it to you. So Here's what I've been talking about, hand pollination. See some little cups down at the bottom, see some paintbrushes, see someone collecting it in the bottom right. So pollen is collected from the stamens in the male stage in late afternoon, evening, early morning. So you remove that and you use it right away if you have some females that are ready, if they're glistening and ready to go, or you put it on paper, allow it to dry out, and you store it overnight. Pollen can then be mixed with lycopodium dust or talcum powder. Then hand pollination is most effective early to mid-morning. That's when the females will be ready, and may be effective by using a thin camel hair brush like you see down below. And you put that onto the female parts. That's going to give you much, much better fruit set, and the fruit are going to be very well shaped. So here we see the top left. That's the male stage flower. It's all the way open. Then you're going to collect that pollen in B, and then C, the far right, you're going to apply that to the female stage. And there's a study they did down here at the bottom that actually shows why this works. So hand pollination, to finish up, use the pollen immediately or with 18 hours. That will give you the highest percent fruit set, the largest and heaviest fruit, more seeds per fruit, higher percentage of symmetrical fruit, and the greatest percent commercially acceptable fruit. So the way they know this is true is they did a study, and this is the study here. So that's how the Tropical Research Education Center works. They actually do studies of these. Liette Works says, do you keep the pollen in the refrigerator? No, I would not. Okay, the growth habit. Here's a sugar apple on the right. Like I said, they defoliate over the winter, so they get pretty ugly. There, you can see this one is, looks like it's starting to get a little ugly. Then it refoliates during the spring, and it will flower and continue to flush during the spring through the summer. And then in the fall, it stops flushing, and then it begins the cycle again. So here's some close-up pictures that I took. Here's a sugar apple in the left. You see, you might look at that and think, oh, something's wrong with my tree. There's a Guanábana soursop to the right. And that's just that it's getting closer to winter, so they're going to drop their leaves or they're just pulling some energy back into the tree. They're not hurting at all. That's what they do. Now, the Guanábana and the soursop is much more cold sensitive. So if we get a good cold front, and I'm not talking about freezing, but if we get a cool front, they will show it in their leaves. They'll be damaged. If we get freezing, they're really going to be damaged. We have a freeze. So here's some cultivars and selections. Here's some names. And you see the Lasard tie here and the red down here. These are not grown in Florida. The Crimson, Washington, Benny Mazar, Abdel Razik. These are grown here. Here's the Leah Reese, very nice, good looking. And one thing that you might wonder is, when are they ready to pick? Because they don't really turn different colors like a mango or some different fruits. So when you see them sort of open up like this, this one's pretty far open. So even before this stage, so here you see all the parts of the fruit are touching, they're together, but on the right, you see them kind of opening up. When you see them opening up on the tree, you can cut that off and then it will mature. Oh, Jorge, I didn't know that. So Lee and Reese are Dr. Crane's granddaughters. Very cool. Jorge is always there with the history. Very nice, thank you, sir. So here's some Atemoya cultivars. You can see them there. Geffner is really the one that we would want to grow, and I'll show you that. So here's Geffner, top left, African Pride, Guzman. More history being dropped in the chat, everyone. So these were Atemoya cultivars tested in Florida. So again, the Tropical Research Education Center did testing on this. So commercial potential, poor. Requires hand pollination for some of these. So another one, poor, and then Geffner, excellent. So if you're gonna grow one, that might be the one you wanna think about. And then poor. So that could have been a much shorter chart. Just say, here's a good one. The rest are poor. So Guanábana cultivars, don't have a lot of information on named cultivars. Some selections have been made here and abroad. I had a grower come in. That was the picture I showed you of the one in my hand. It was a really giant Guanábana. And he said that all his are like that. And the seedlings are like that as well. So I'm actually going to get one of his seedlings. And speaking of propagation, I saw we had a question about propagation in the chat. Seedling trees are very common with sugar apples. And if seeds are used from fruit where several species or cultivars are grown, they may not come true from seed. So if you have a lot of the same cultivars of sugar apple close together, the seedlings are going to be very close to the parent. So you can grow them from seed and they will fruit quicker than like a mango or an avocado from seed. You can veneer and cleft graft them or shield bud. This is grafting. It's a technique. It's an asexual technique of propagation where you're actually cloning the parent plant. And we do have a Tropical Fruit Tuesday on grafting that you can check out. There's lots of good videos on grafting. You don't have to watch a whole 40 minutes of mine. So Atemoyas and Guanábana, I think that's the question we had about Atemoyas. Atemoya seeds are very variable because remember, they're a combination of the sugar apple and the cherry moya. So you can't just plant a seed to get the exact same one back. There are commercial cultivars that are veneer or cleft grafted or shield bud or patch. And Atemoyas, you can graft them onto another Atemoya. So you take a seedling Atemoya, take the Atemoya that you want, like Geffner, and then you graft them together. That's going to be a more vigorous tree. If you want to slow it down, you can graft an Atemoya to a sugar apple seedling. And Guanábana, commonly grown from seed, but can be grafted if you have a really good one, like that really huge one that that gentleman brought in. That would be one to think about grafting. So here's a grove of Atemoyas on the left. You see they kind of spread a little more side to side and then they shoot up in the middle. I have some in the back that are, I'm dying to prune them, but it's not quite time to prune them yet. And then you see sugar apples, they're a little more compact side to side and they don't shoot up quite as much in the center. So here's a cultural practice chart for annonas. And you can find this chart. Don't worry about taking a picture of it or trying to memorize it, because you can find this chart if you go to Ask IFAS, put in annonas, and then there'll be a publication on, I think it's growing sugar apples in the home landscape. And then that chart will be in there. And we have these charts for mango, avocado, longan, lychee. So very useful, and they're in those publications in Ask IFAS. So you could go Ask IFAS, put in mango, and you'd find a very big publication, like 15 pages with great information on mango, including this chart, which has when to look for disease, when to look for insects. And you see the big diseases are anthracnose and the seed borer. These two kind of go together. And I think I saw something in the chat about the fruit turning black. That's these combination of two, and I'll show you why. When to fertilize, NPK, secondary minor nutrients, iron soil drench, So you do that in sort of the wet season, you can see here. Irrigation, when you would do that, most tropical fruit, you can irrigate a little bit from flowering to harvest to help pump up the fruit a little bit. Weed control, pruning. Pruning is in the spring, right there. So frost protection, when you would have to think about that. And we did just have two workshops on cold protection. So the links to those should be out soon. I'll put that out to my whole email list. Kenny asked, what's the best NPK ratio for annonas? NPK are the three numbers you'll find on a fertilizer bag. So it's nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. And typical fruit NPK range is 8-3-9. I think that would work good for the annonas. So an 8-3-9, it's a tropical fruit, very common tropical fruit mix. Okay, so these are the nutrient levels, which you might need this if you're sampling the leaves. If you're sending in the leaves and finding out what's wrong with them, you would send them in, and these are the ranges that we would try to fall into. So most people won't need this unless they're doing leaf sampling. But typically in South Florida, it's gonna be not enough micro elements, so not enough iron. Maybe if you're fertilizing too much nitrogen, you don't really usually need to do the leaf test because we have high pH in our soil. So all the minor elements, it's hard for the tree to get it unless you're giving it to the tree. So annonas, easy to prune and manage. I believe so. I think compared to some other trees, like I think lychee is more difficult. Mamay is more difficult. Carambola is one that's pretty easy, and I think annonas fall into the easier column because when you prune them, they come back really nice and you can really shape them. So here is a sugar apple tree on the right. You can see that it's getting towards the winter because it's dropped a lot of leaves, so it's not ready to prune quite yet, but it's going to be pruned when it's the spring. So tree training, tree size control, reasons for tree size control. This is why you prune. Maintain the light levels and lower productive canopy. So you want the lower part to stay productive. You improve crop production, increase air movement. So that reduces disease. And also makes it harder for a hurricane to knock it over when they're smaller, and you have less fruit scarring. So suggested tree size varies. I would say, 12 to 15 feet would be good. That way it's much easier to pick. The warmer the climate, the more vigorous the growth. We know that. So South Florida, Miami-Dade, you're going to get it pretty vigorous. The wider the spacing. Now, this is for commercial growers when you're putting a lot in a row, the longer it takes to require regular pruning. So if you have them further apart, you can let them grow a little wider. And if they're closer, you can't let them do that. Ariel asks, how do you conduct the leaves nutritional analysis? You take the leaves and you send it in to a company. On my website, if you search Tropical Fruit Production, Miami-Dade Extension, Tropical Fruit Production, Miami-Dade Extension. You'll find my page that has all kinds of good information for you guys. If you got an email from me, at the very bottom, there's a link that says Commercial Tropical Fruit Production. If you click on that, it goes to the same page. And there I have a list of places you can send the leaves for analysis if you want to. So smaller trees are easier to spray, hand pollinate, and harvest. So smaller is good, not tiny, but 12 feet, really nice. So here we are in our early spring pruning. On the left, top left, you see a tree that hasn't been pruned yet. And then on the right, you see it's been thinned out, but keeping these nice scaffold branches. So on the left, you see a tree that hasn't been pruned yet. And on the right, you see it's kind of been cut back all around and left a lot of these scaffold branches. So Steve says Trek used to do it, meaning the leaf nutrition analysis. But I don't think they do anymore, Steve. I really don't. And like Steve says, when you do send it in, they will. You need to check with them of how they want it. You can't just send like old leaves. You need to check of exactly how they want it. They probably want leaves from different parts of the plant. If you have a grove, leaves from different trees within the grove. So top left, you have a tree that has not been pruned yet. And you see very many branches. So what you want to do is this one in the middle here, bottom right, where you leave a nice scaffold branches and you sort of have a modified central leader. So it's not going straight up. On the right, this one isn't terrible, but you see the branches start higher up. So that's not great. This one in the middle or bottom right, you see the branches are very low and you get fruit there. They're not heavy, so they won't sag the branches down. So that's ideal. Over on the bottom left, open center low. This has a chance for splitting, so I don't love it. It's better than I think this top right and certainly better than unpruned. Kenny asks, how long do seeds typically take to germinate? Do they prefer bottom heat? Should they be scarified? I don't know. I've never planted them and propagated them from seed. I would guess, though, that they're pretty quick. That's just a guess, and they don't need to be scarified. But it's always good to check. And I'm sure I could find that information if you want, Kenny, if you want to email me. That would be good. I don't think they're going to need bottom heat because it's so warm here, unless you're in a cool area. Mary Waters, thank you. She says about 30 days to germinate, so that's not bad. So commercial growers prune like this. They have a big machine that has these big circular blades on them, and they go through. The top left is what's called topping. You do topping and hedging. So they're doing the tops, and then you would actually do the sides hedging. And sometimes you do topping 1 year, hedging the next year, so you don't prune too much off at a time. And then the bottom right, you see it's been topped right there. So that's how they do it. It's much, much easier than hand pruning, and it's going to be cheaper. So that's why commercially you have to do it that way. So Jorge, who would know about this, says you can scarify them or rub on sandpaper, but not always needed. So it might be a good idea to rub them a little bit on some sandpaper, and that will open up the seed coat for the water to get in there so it can germinate. So here we see the topping going on. You see this big machine, and that's still how these machines look. So you see the bottom right just chopping it like that. And I would love for, if you do this, I would love for you to take all those branches and chip them up and use them under the tree, or just put them under the tree and chop them up with a hand lopper instead of hauling them away. Put them back into the ground. So this is what I talked about harvesting. You see the top right. These guys are ready to pick. You see they're kind of spread. You see that pink in between. The bottom right, this one's not really well shaped because it didn't get pollinated well. But this one, if you see one like that on the bottom right where it's that far apart, it's probably gone a little far. It's probably ready to eat right off the tree. So commercially, that wouldn't be the way to go. You'd want to pick it more like this or a little before that even. So diseases, anthracnose is really the one, and mixing that with the seed borer. So the seed borer gets into the seeds and it drills into the fruit, and that opens it up for the fungus. So on the right, you see this mummification, which if you guys grow sugar apples or Atemoyas, you've seen this. And that's the seed borer, the circle I made there. You see the little dot where it went in, opened it up to fungus, and it mummified like this. So this is difficult to control. I haven't found a great way to do it. I think bagging would be the best way. I haven't been able to try that yet. One thing I do try to do is take the ones that are mummified and get them away from the tree. That hasn't worked that great. I'll show you some other ideas. And then if you see this left picture on a guanabana, you'll see this on a guanabana, these little bumps. I've been asked about this several times. And this is an Aranos mite. It's a very, very tiny microscopic mite that causes this. And it shouldn't be a big problem. It's not like the lychee Aranos mite where it will get on the fruit and cause problems that way. So here's the mummification, the fruit rot. It's caused by the seed borer getting in there. So control strategies, monitor for this and spray insecticides. If you're not hand pollinating, that could kill some of your pollinators. So be careful there. Eradicate winter hosts, the annona reticulata. I actually did that. That's the ones that went down in the Hurricane Irma, but that didn't really work. So I can tell you that doesn't work. Isolate the plantings from nearby annonas and bagging the fruit. I'm going to try that because that seems like the only way that will work for me. Victoria asked, what's a good source for bagging the sugar apple? That I don't know, but I know they bag guavas with just plastic bags. So that may be a way to go. And they do put a little styrofoam wrap around it so the bags aren't touching the fruit. If anybody knows where is a good source to get bags for fruit, put that in the chat. So here's the seed borer. There's the seeds that have been attacked. And finally, this is sugar apple fruit nutrient content. So we have all this information. It's got lots of nutrients. Here's the source down below. And I do want to see you guys at the next Tropical Fruit Tuesday. We'll be on seed propagation December 14th. And then the avocado will be January 18th. Now I'm going to put in the chat a link to the survey. It's just a 3-minute survey. If you could click on that link or scan the QR code, it will take you to the survey. Really take you 2 to 3 minutes, super quick, but it helps me out a lot, especially for my reporting. Anna knows about that. I see her in the chat. So if you could take that, that would really help me a lot. And happy Thanksgiving to you too, Mr. Lyons. So thank you guys so much for coming. I really appreciate you. I think we had a good talk today. We're right at 2:44, so we're ready to say goodbye, but I wanna keep this QR code up for you guys. You're quite welcome, Mr. Dalton. Good to see you here. Thanks to everyone. I appreciate you guys. And of course, all of you are welcome. So thank you guys so much. If you could take that survey, I'm going to put it one more time in the chat. Yes, happy Thanksgiving, Anna. So thank you. Thank you, Jorge, and thank you, Dr. Green, for all your help in the chat. Thank you to the others, Mary Waters, who helped out in the chat. Thank you to anyone else that helped in the chat. So I'm going to take this down. So either scan it now or get the link. Cherie, happy Thanksgiving to you. And thank you guys so much. Oops. I appreciate you guys. Have a good rest of your week and happy Thanksgiving. Have a great long weekend.